A very good morning and welcome to the 25th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. We have got no apologies this morning and Katie Clark is joining us online. So our first item of business today is the continuation of evidence sessions on the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill. So last week we began with an overview session on the bill with the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs, Angela Constance. And today we move on to phase one of our evidence taking on the bill, which will focus specifically on taking evidence on parts one, two and three of the bill. So these parts of the bill cover the establishment of a Victims and Witnesses Commissioner, embedding trauma-informed practice in the justice system and extending special measures to civil cases. So we expect phase one to run to around mid-November, after which we will move on to considering other parts of the bill. And we're joined this morning by a panel of organisations who represent victims and survivors of various crimes. So a warm welcome to Anne-Marie Kokoza, co-founder of FAMS, which is Families and Friends Affected by Murder and Suicide, Sandy Brindley, Chief Executive of Rape Crisis Scotland, Dr. Marcia Scott, Chief Executive Officer at Scottish Women's Aid, and Kate Wallace, Chief Executive Officer at Victim Support Scotland. So warm welcome to you all. And I refer members to papers 1, 2 and 3. And I intend to allow up to 75 minutes for this session. Now, before we get underway with such a large panel, I'd like to ask members to be as succinct with your questions and panel members to be as succinct with your responses as possible. And I remind everyone that we're focusing on parts one to three of the bill in this first phase. So if we can, let's try to work through parts one to three in turn in our questions. So I'll begin with an opening question on part one of the bill, namely the proposal for a Victims and Witnesses Commissioner. So I'd like to ask, what are your views on the pros and cons of such a post? And I'm going to start with Sandy Brindley and then I'll bring in Dr. Marcia Scott. As I know, Rape Crisis Scotland are supportive of the proposal and Scottish Women's Aid are more opposed to the creation of the post. So, Sandy, I'll bring you in first.
Yes, at Rape Crisis Scotland, we probably started off in the taking a similar position to Scottish Women's Aid, which has been quite sceptical of the need for a Victims Commissioner, but also the benefits of it, given that a commissioner can get involved in individual cases. And the reason we've changed our position somewhat is because there have been a number of victims speaking out, not specifically of sexual offences, but more generally, saying this is something they would value. I do still have some concerns about victim expectations being that a commissioner can assist with their case. I also worry about the cost of it. So we are, I think we're all aware the government are in a very difficult financial position. We're looking at losing 20 rape crisis workers across Scotland from next March. So it does make it quite difficult for us to support wholeheartedly the Victims Commissioner when frontline services are being decimated. So I think we do need to see it in the context of the financial position and what the priorities should be and what's most important for victims and survivors.
Okay, thank you very much for that. And I'm just going to move straight on to Dr. Scott.
It's quite uncomfortable actually opposing this in the sense that we really see ourselves as an organisation that advocates for any expansion of access to power for victims and survivors. And we've had multiple discussions amongst my colleagues about this. But it came down to a couple of things for us. When the idea of a victims commissioner was first mooted, I had conversations with Sarah Mason, who's the CEO of Women's Aid Federation Northern Ireland, with Sarah, I know a lot of Sarahs, Sarah Fitzpatrick, who's the CEO of Wales Women's Aid, and both Nicole Jacobs, who's the commissioner, domestic abuse commissioner in England, and Farah Nazir, who's the chief exec in Women's Aid Federation England. And the reason I listed all those is because the response I got was unanimous from all of them, which was that they felt that Scotland was in, and the violence against women sector in Scotland was in a singular and unique position in the UK in terms of having really good access to politicians, to ministers, to MSPs, and that creating an institution that would then stand between us and them was retrograde, you know, would actually interfere with that. On top of that, our concern has been that we have, and also in some of those areas, they have victims commissioners, and they have not been convinced that they have helped get the voices of victims and survivors. I mean, you know, there's the, I'm listening to you, but then there's the actually policy changes as a result of what you said, and they said those are two very different things. On top of that, we heard from one of them that that there's a high risk of getting somebody in as a victims commissioner who does not understand violence against women and girls well, and certainly does not have what we would consider gender competence when it comes to looking at criminal and civil justice issues around domestic abuse. And that then for us is very, very risky, because then the person who is supposedly speaking for the people that we serve actually doesn't understand what they need and want. So I would say the first, you know, I had these conversations with previous multiple cabinet secretaries for justice. I'm not sure that they were as convinced as they might have been that this was a good idea. And I would hope that the parliament will reconsider it. The other possible alternative is, and this was suggested in the independent review of funding for frontline services that was just published in June, May, that if we have a victims commissioner, then we need a domestic abuse commissioner. And that would be I'm worried, like Sandy, about the money that would go in. I still don't want somebody between us and government. But if we have a victims commissioner, the only way I can imagine that we could really reduce the risk would be to have a domestic abuse commissioner.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. I'm going to bring in other members now, because I know this is what you've just outlined, Marcia, is something that I think we're all very sensitive to. So I'm going to bring in Russell Finlay first.
Thanks very much. Two questions. I'll try and be brief. Victim Support Scotland said in their submission that they want to know what action the Commissioner might be able to take in respect of criminal justice agencies that aren't doing their jobs properly. Essentially, will the Commissioner have teeth? And apparently this is what victims are calling for. And connected to that, going back to the point about not being able to act in individual cases, again, I think victims would like to see that power. Otherwise, what's the point other than to generate whole reams of paperwork for people like us to read? What can be done, I suppose the question is to Kate, because it relates to your evidence, to give the Commissioner teeth?
So, yeah, I mean, I think a couple of things to remember about the Victims Commissioner proposal in the bill. This came from victims themselves, who overwhelmingly wanted it. They wanted the establishment of a figurehead who would champion the rights and hold criminal justice agencies to account. A lack of accountability in the criminal justice system is something that this committee has talked about a lot, and we see the Commissioner's role as being key in relation to that. There's obviously a number of actions that the Commissioner could take in respect to that, and the accountability role in terms of standards of service, for example, and holding organisations to account for their standards of service under the Victims Code is one of them, and it's something that we really need and we really want to see, because at the moment those rights are meaningless because no one's been held to account for that. So yeah, we would like more clarity and detail around that, but I think that's it's worth remembering that that is, yes, you're right, absolutely why victims were behind it and who wanted it. So this is a provision in the bill that victims have asked for directly themselves. Victim Support Europe, I think it's worth saying that in a report they produced last week, have said that an independent victims commissioner is key for a good fabric around victims' rights and upholding victims' rights in each of the member states. They see it as good practice. And what we think should happen in respect to the second point that you made is that the Victims Commissioner role should mirror the Children's Commissioner role with respect to powers. Like Sandy, we do seek reassurance around funding, that the funding for this doesn't impact on frontline victim support services. We're still seeking that assurance. And victims, their feedback has been it needs enough resource to have weight behind it and to be able to do its function, but it should not be a bloated office like we've seen with some other. So getting that kind of sweet spot in between, I think, is really, really important. But having a figurehead who champions victims' rights, who does hold organisations to account, and who is not conflicted in their role, they're there solely for victims. And I absolutely agree with Marcia's point. They need to be the skills and experience. It's absolutely right that we get the right person with the right skills, knowledge and experience. That's crucial. I think that can be done within the processes that are there.
Thank you. Yeah, of course.
Really briefly on that, and the question of how to make rights meaningful and to hold bodies to account. I think the most effective way of doing that is to provide access to legal advice, thinking particularly for sexual offence complainers. There's a right, for example, to information in the 2014 Act that really is pretty meaningless because there is no way of victims being able to assert that right. And the way to effectively enable them to assert that right is to provide access to legal advice and representation where a solicitor acting in that case can assert those rights on behalf of that individual victim. I think that is what victims are looking for rather than for a figurehead.
Which is probably more part three related.
Absolutely.
But yeah, indeed. Okay. And the next question is, there's been some general disquiet within Parliament about the number of commissioners in Scotland. There are seven costing £16.5 million. There's seven more potentially in the pipeline. The Victims Commissioner is going to cost up to £1 million. And I think some evidence that we've had from the various organisations, this creates risking extra layers of bureaucracy and might actually clutter the landscape even further. Now, Kenny Gibson, who's the Finance Committee convener, has talked of a sunset clause for commissioners, generally. Therefore, if a commissioner has deemed to have achieved its work, there should be some kind of mechanism whereby it could be disbanded. Would that go some way, perhaps, Dr. Scott, towards meeting your concerns?
I was just having a little snort moment there, sorry, because I was trying to imagine a situation in which I would love the idea of our saying, okay, we don't need you anymore because we've eradicated domestic abuse in Scotland.
Could the sunset clause be brought in if they weren't doing their jobs properly then?
No. Yeah, well, I mean, I think that what we would want would be a sunset clause that operated when they'd done their job so effectively that we didn't need them anymore. And if they're not doing their job properly, that the problem possibly could be solved by other ways than eliminating the commissioner post. Can I just add here, you know, I don't really disagree with anything that my colleagues have said. I think we all just fit, we want to be in the same place, but we have different ideas about how to get there. But the problem that we're all trying to solve is accountability. You know, that's the problem, is that from our perspective and from the women and children that my organization supports, the system doesn't change in response to the things that they say. I don't think putting in a figurehead, and maybe it will help, I'm not arguing that it might help, but then that gets everybody off the hook of actually changing the way the system operates to hold itself accountable. And I would be very unhappy if anybody thought that they'd solved the problem of accountability by creating a commissioner.
Yeah, okay, thank you. I'm conscious of time, so.
Thank you very much. I'm going to bring in John Swinney and then Rona Mackay.
Thank you very much, Kavira. I'd like to pursue the issue of accountability, if I might, because I'm very struck by the point that Kate Wallace made about and the point that Dr. Scott has just made about the importance of things changing in response to there being concerns about practice. And I think there's some fundamental dilemmas here which I think are we have to be really careful about in relation to expectations about a victims commissioner. So I want to talk particularly about accountability around the Crown and accountability around the legal profession. To be clear, that so the committee can understand your perspective about where accountability should be, you know, exercised in this proposal. So would it be your view, for example, that there has to be some line of accountability between the Crown and the Victims Commissioner for the decisions the Crown makes in relation to criminal cases? I think Kate Wallace would, right, yeah, please.
Yeah, I mean, I think there are the Crown already have standards of service in relation to victims set out in the Victims Code. The ultimate process for that at the moment is going ultimately to the Public Service Ombudsman. Victims don't use that often. They often, and part of the issue as well is that it's not always clear about which body it is that they should be pursuing in respect of how they have been treated and how you know, and how their situation has developed. So clarifying that within a commissioner's role, I think, in terms of, as I say, mirroring what happens with the Children's Commissioner, where in respect of action that's already been taken in an individual case is excluded, but there is an ability within the Children's Commissioner role to investigate individual circumstances if it hasn't already been taken through a process through other bodies. We think that's helpful. We also think that what you see, and it is there already in the provision of in the bill around themes that come up, so common issues in terms of the way that people have been treated, that a commissioner role around that and you know, resolving some of those issues and accountability. But yeah, I think what we're asking for is for the role to mirror that of the Children's Commissioner role.
Thank you for that answer. It does beg the question, if the route exists through the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman for some of these issues to be pursued, if the standards of service have not been applied or are considered not to be applied, that the argument for a victims commissioner is that we need to have a victims commissioner because the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman is not effective, which would rather play into the hands of we're creating another commissioner to deal with the fact that a commissioner we're already paying for is not that effective. You see my line of argument?
The commissioner role is wider, though, I think, than the Public Service Ombudsman role. And it's around, so the Public Service Ombudsman role is around complaint and the ultimate complaint process. It's not that well. You can see they publish their cases at the moment. You can see for yourself that it's not that well used within the criminal justice system at all. It's mostly used around areas like health. The decisions are public. It's not embedded within the criminal justice system. It's a very, 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 very broad role. And inevitably, what often happens when you can look at their judgments that they've made in terms of complaints as well. What they often say is that the victims' code, victims' rights under the standards of service have not been met through this organisation, for example, COPFS, and that's the decision of the commissioner's role would be much wider than that in terms of being able to take forward the learning from that, take forward where there's commonalities, which we all know that there are in terms of issues around how victims are treated within the system. And I think you're right, though, in terms of being absolutely clear around, you know, with victims, and this is Sandy's point earlier on, around managing expectation. So, for example, we put in our submission whether that ability to investigate individual circumstances and the mirroring of the Children's Commissioner's role or not exists. I think what really does need to happen is this is what the Commissioner does and this is what the Commissioner doesn't do, like they've got in Australia, so that's absolutely spelled out.
If I could move on then to the question of accountability around the legal profession, because other committees of this Parliament are looking at the regulation of the legal profession. And there is very strong messaging been coming to Parliament about the absolute independence of the legal profession, and that cannot be intruded upon, all of which is very important. But it strikes me that some of the issues about the conduct of defence solicitors in the process of interacting with victims raises an awful lot of questions about conduct, actions, standards. So how I'm interested in how the question of accountability can be applied through a commissioner to the conduct of a legal profession that certainly this Parliament is very strongly presented with an argument by the legal profession, indeed in really quite strident terms, must be, its independence must be maintained.
Yeah.
I would like to make a comment here that I think one of the most important ways of making the legal profession accountable is to have clear and transparent complaints processes, which I don't think we have just now. And we've just seen the Faculty of Advocates take 3 years to investigate a complaint against Gordon Jackson for naming complainers on a Glasgow-Edinburgh train. This is not a complaints process that gives accountability. And that would be my priority, would be to ensure that bodies like the Faculty of Advocates have processes in place that are actually accessible for complainers to use. So we have had complainers trying to use these processes to raise concerns about their treatment during cross-examination, but the processes are untransparent, they're lengthy, and they're not accessible. And that would be my priority. And I think that's the way of doing it, where you're in no way compromising the independence of the legal profession, but you're making sure there's very clear processes in place that people can use, and that gives accountability.
Is there a role for a Victims Commissioner in that respect?
Yeah, I think there is. I think that from my perspective, that the Commissioner could be overseeing the quality of those complaints processes, the transparency of them. As I say, at the moment, it's really challenging for victims to understand often what role different organisations have played in which complaints policy. I had this conversation actually with senior member of the Crown a few weeks ago, that even the Crown were struggling to understand which organisation should be complained to about what. There was such a complex issue with so many different aspects, and I think that's the perfect role for a Victims Commissioner to help support around that, and also help make sure that the processes that are in place around complaints are clear and transparent and easily understood by people who need to use them.
Can I very briefly?
I'll do my best. I was actually in this building yesterday morning giving evidence on the regulation of legal services. I think there are two things I want to observe. The first thing would be that I worry less about the independence of the legal community and more about the independence of regulation and the failure to recommend an independent regulator over the legal professions would be an egregious mistake as far as we're concerned. And we are hoping that in the consideration of that other bill, that Parliament chooses to go with an independent regulator, because any system that uses people in its own cohort to regulate themselves delivers you outcomes like the Faculty of Advocates Complaints Commission. Secondly, for me, I think we need to be much more ambitious. I mean, really, are we going to try and fix what we know are deep and decades-long problems in the way victims experience the criminal and civil justice systems by bolstering slightly the complaints process? Surely what we want is accountability that's built into the way the institutions set themselves up and operate and the way we evaluate them, rather than just trying to fix what happens when they don't operate properly and people have a complaint. And in the context of domestic abuse, given that the vast majority are victims are women and children, that they've been re-traumatized by a system. The complaints process is irrelevant to them as far as they're concerned. So I would just say that, the fact of a commissioner helping people make a complaint is not a bad thing, but it's deeply unambitious, I think.
Thank you. I'd just like to bring in Anne-Marie. I'm conscious that you haven't really had an opportunity to come in yet, so just ask you a very broad question about your own views on the proposals around a commissioner.
Well, similar to Kate and to my colleagues, when it was first mooted, myself and everyone at FAMS, the families thought it was a great thing that someone should be, as you say, as Kate says, a champion of the victims. But when we looked at it closer, I think it's very unclear really what the remit is, the person's remit is. I think it's too broad at the moment. It's trying to tick too many boxes. And the fact that they would not be allowed to review individual cases, to me, makes it lose its teeth. So I share really the same views as Kate in particular, and probably as Kate. Yeah.
Okay, thanks very much, Anne-Marie. Okay, I'm going to bring in Rona Mackay, followed by Fulton McGregor. And again, if I can ask for succinct questions and responses. Thank you,
Convener. Good morning. Can I come to Sandy first, please? Just you said at the start that you weren't wholeheartedly convinced, and I understand your arguments about it being another voice for victims, etc. So what parts of it, you know, would make you convinced that we should have one, and would that be the fact that they could intervene directly in cases, or could you maybe just clarify what would solidify in your mind that we definitely should have one?
Yes, I think that the reason that we have supported it to a degree is that victims are saying this is something that they want, so that feels quite difficult for us to oppose. I think we have reflected somewhat on some of the submissions that have been made to the committee, where it seems like there isn't a unified view across victims that this is something that they want, or that they only want it if it can intervene in individual cases. So I think it's fair to say our position now is a bit more neutral than it was. And in terms of sexual offence complainers, which is who I'm representing, when we consulted with sexual offence complainers, that there was similar ambivalence. Some people thought it could be a good thing. Other people worried that it wouldn't really do anything.
Leads me on to my next question, which is, in your vast experience, all of you, given the trauma that all of the victims that you support have been through, how many of them do you think would take up, you know, go down the route of saying, I want to go to the Victims Commissioner on this? I mean, just, I know you can't say exactly because it's not happened yet, but just roughly, what is your feeling that they would actually think, that's where I want to go now, given everything that they've been through?
People definitely want to have a voice overwhelmingly. There's a real appetite, I think, from victims and survivors to be able to use their experience to make things better for other people. We've seen that just with, I mean, we have 60 people now in our survivor reference group at Rape Crisis Scotland, and these are all people that want to take what's generally been a very negative experience and use it to try and make things better. So I think there's certainly an appetite for being involved and contributing to change, whether or not the way to do that is through a victims commissioner or other routes, but there's no doubt there's an appetite for it.
I mean, we asked that question of it. So we've, similar to Sandy, we've got two reference groups, one across the whole organisation that's got about 60 people in it, and another one for our service supporting families bereaved by crime. All except one person out of, and that's about 70-odd people, expressed an interest in engaging with the Victims Commissioner role directly about, either from the perspective of, you know, speaking about their own experience in order to make sure that that did not happen to anybody else. I think, you know, from our perspective, we see it as something helpful. We see it as something that would be all of our responsibilities to help make it work in the right way, and we understand the arguments about money and so forth, so we would be looking for assurances that it would not impact on frontline services. That would be the main thing. But yeah, there would be a lot of people wanting to engage with Victims Commissioner from where I'm sitting, definitely.
Thank you. You'd said that you felt a bit disappointed because they wouldn't be able to intervene in individual cases. So would that make a difference to people saying, well, Good point.
I think 100% our lived experience supporter groups, when I said I was coming here and been asked questions, they were 100% that they would like to have the commissioner see a commissioner, and that they would be more than welcome, more, you know, the appetite, as you say, would be there for them to contact them on their individual cases, and also to prevent what they feel they have gone through and any other family having to go through that. But mostly, I think, when they feel wronged by the system, and not to have their voices heard adds to their recovery from the trauma, I think. They feel the frustration and not being heard. So I think it would be a good thing.
OK, yeah. That's really interesting. Thank you, Kevin.
Thanks very much. I'll bring in Fulton, followed...
I'll be the sole voice here. I do think that lots of survivors, the survivors who get involved in all of our reference groups, are really committed to trying to get change. And if there's another avenue for trying to do that, they will certainly use it. But if you look at, you know, I mean, it will be very skewed to upper middle class, or, you know, to people who have the energy and the finances and the safety to engage. So, you know, for most of the folks we support, you know, it would just be a burden that would just not be available. So we would wind up doing it again to somebody who is now between us and government rather than directly to government.
I understand that, yep.
Thank you. I'll bring in Fulton and then Pauline McNeill. If I can ask members just to direct questions to maybe two witnesses at the most, because we've still got parts two and three to get through.
Thanks, Convener. I think it feels like almost all the panel are roughly in the same place today. You've got some people who are... Like yourself, Marcia, are opposed to the Commissioner, but can see some good points with it, and others like yourself, Sandy, who are for it, but with huge caveats. So what I wanted to ask is, I apologise to the Convener, but it is a bit of a general question. If the Parliament or the Government decide to withdraw this particular part of the bill, how do you think that the main aims of what the Commissioner is trying to establish, a commissioner is trying to do, can be achieved through existing mechanisms, either statutory ones or voluntary ones that are already in place? Marshall, you're nodding, so I'll come to you first, if that's okay.
Of course we've thought about that. And actually, Kate and I were both in a meeting yesterday with officials and the Deputy Director of Justice to talk about the vision for justice and delivering it. And... I think that's where the questions for us are about where do you put accountability in the system, and how do you get the system to start talking about who it's going. So one of the themes of the discussion was the fact that so often we have these high level commitments by the government and the parliament, you know, that say, well, we're going to do this and we're going to do that, but they don't say who they're going to do it for, how they're going to prioritize the resources, what's the change that we're going to look for, and how we're going to measure our success. And I know it sounds like I'm asking for smart targets, and actually I am really not. I am asking for people to prioritize. We are in a very constrained resource situation. There is no way that some of the things that are being said are going to be accomplished can be accomplished for all victims. So what we need is a really hard discussion about who's the priority victims here, and how are we going to manage the resources that we have to have the biggest impact? You know, if there were an easy answer, we would have figured this out. But I also think it's about how does Parliament hold the government accountable for delivering change and paying attention rather over time. So when I think about the domestic abuse bill, I'm so sorry, Audrey, I know I'm going on too long. When I think about the domestic abuse bill, for instance, it was built into it that the government would have to report, ministers would have to report back to the parliament 3 years after the bill was passed. The information that was available in COVID was a problem, but was really scant in that three-year report. And the parliament needs to have said, well, these are the things we want to know, and you're not giving them to us. Do you know what I mean? Or thank you for A and B, but C and D are missing. We'd like you to come back. So it's those kinds of things. It's everybody's responsibility to hold accountable. So anyway, sorry, I'll stop.
Sandy, I get asked only to ask two.
Very briefly.
If I had to, as a means of providing accountability and making rights real, which I think is what we're talking about here, if I had to choose between providing legal advice to sexual offence complainers or a victims commissioner, if it was a choice between those two things in terms of resources, I would absolutely choose legal advice. I think that is the only way to make rights real. We have a lot of good words in this bill, particularly in trauma-informed practice. And the biggest question I think facing this committee is, how do you make that actually mean something on the ground? And my view is the way to make that mean something on the ground in reality is provide access to legal advice to enable people to assert their rights effectively.
Okay, thank you. I'll bring in Pauline McNeill and then Sharon Dowie, and then we'll have to move on. Pauline.
Thank you. Good morning. I start by sort of posing the question about that the previous members have posed about the effectiveness of commissioners who have appointed in the past. I mean, I cite, for example, the Children's Commissioner. All the legislation here in this Parliament has been initiated by a government, and I'm struggling to actually think about a substantive issue which the Human Rights Commission have raised in the Parliament that hasn't been determined by a court. So I suppose those where my questions are coming from. And also to follow on from John Swinney's questions about accountability and whether or not one person, one post holder could actually do all this, hold the Lord Advocate to account, hold the legal profession to account, hold the court to account. I do really question whether, and that's desirable, obviously. We all agree that's desirable. But it just seems to me to wrap this all up in one person, it seems to me very difficult to envisage how that really could work. So I suppose that's my question to Kate Wallace. I mean, do you accept any of that?
I think that at the moment, this committee has spoken a lot about lack of accountability throughout the whole of the justice system, and it goes back to your question earlier on around if you don't have this, how do you do that? Well, that's my question back to you. I don't, without this post as a key component of an approach around accountability, I don't see how you can do that. Obviously, I've got views about expanding the range of organisations that have standards of service under the Victims Code, because there are many statutory services that are not in there. I could talk at length about that, but I won't. But I think the other, I would flip that question round. We've got a problem of lack of accountability. I'm hugely sceptical about whether or not we'll manage to do it. We haven't managed to do it so far yet. We see the Commissioner as being a key role within that. I don't think they would be able to do it all on their own, but I think they would be a key part of a change to the system that makes victims' rights meaningful and holds organisations to account on that. But I think it's part of a whole system change, is how I see it.
I would agree with that. I think we all agree that the whole... But you're convinced that one person, the Commissioner, could hold all these criminal justice agencies to account? That's your organisation.
I think
position.
If we all got, I mean, my view about the Children's Commissioner role is that it is up to all of us. If it goes ahead, it would be up to all of us to support that role to be as effective as it possibly could. It's something that victims are asking for. It's what they want. And there are other, there would be other mechanisms.
But what, what victims are asking for, I think Anne-Marie said, is a voice. It is a voice in a system where they feel submerged by lack of accountability. So the question is whether or not what's the way forward, and it seems to me that the question that Rape Crisis poses is the legal advocacy. Would that not strike you as, I suppose this question is to Anne-Marie as well, that some legal advocacy, you could see how they could be more accountable to in terms of court proceedings, coordination. The committee have heard ad infinitum, and through your organisation, Kate, just the terrible experience of victims not being advised of court changes. I just wonder, would the money not be better spent putting that into legal advocacy, where you could have a hands-on person to try and bring those things to account?
as far as I'm aware, there's not a proposal on the table anywhere about giving legal representation to all victims. So,
and what would they do? Where would they go with it? They could get legal advice and be told, "Oh, this is what you should be doing, and this is your rights." So at the end of the day, they're still back where they were in the first instance. Only they've got it, you know, in writing that this is their rights. They've still not got anywhere to go with it. So I would see that the commissioner would be the key player. And yes, there's advisory groups and all that would assist that position. It wouldn't be, that person wouldn't be doing it on his own. It would just be to be, the notes I've taken is to make sure that the advisory groups were fit for purpose and that they had the right people, including victims and survivors and all the other bodies around to do that. So yeah, I think that if not that, then what else? Because there's nothing. Just now, when our families want to complain, and we just write to the Justice Minister, the Cabinet, because that's where we start. We just start at the top and then let them put it, go down the way, because there isn't any focal point for them to start with, not anything that's reasonable and gets results.
Just lastly, sorry, my questions are more to Kate and Amini, obviously, because you support the proposal for the Commissioner. I just wondered, Kate, how do you see the interaction between Victim Support Scotland and a Victims Commissioner? How do you think that would work?
In the same way, I suppose, that children's organisations work alongside the Children's Commissioner and other of our sister organisations in England and Wales, who, interestingly enough, have just put out a public call to make sure that the Victims Commissioner in England's post, which has been vacant for a year, is filled. We would work alongside the Commissioner. We would see it as part of, part of a clear mechanism in order to help with accountability. I would see an answer to your question earlier on about access and about victims directly getting access to the Commissioner. We would see a role as facilitating that and helping that to make sure that all victims who wanted to speak to the Victims Commissioner could. So we would see our role really as working alongside that. I don't see us being in competition. I don't see that role as taken away from anything. I see it as adding something. That's our perspective. So we would do everything we could to help make that role as effective as possible.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. And very quickly, Sharon Dowie. I'm sorry to rush you, Sharon.
Thank you. We've both spoken about accountability. So we've already got a Cabinet Secretary and a Minister that are accountable to Parliament. I see you all as the voices of victims and witnesses. So I'm trying to work out what the benefit would be of bringing in what would be another layer of bureaucracy, and whether your voices would then end up getting diminished because it's going through one person. So rather than hearing from, say, the likes of the four of you, we hear from one person. So we'd be maybe end up missing some of the messages. And I'm wondering if the cost, which is nearly £640,000 to set up in year one and then £615,000 ongoing, would that money not be better spent on your organisations rather than going on a Victims Commissioner? If I could put it to Kate first and then maybe Sandy.
So, yeah, in terms of the first part about the voice, as I said earlier on, it doesn't work that way with the Children's Commissioner. The Children's Commissioner isn't the sole voice, and then other children's organisations are not at the table. That's not how it works, and I would see the Victims Commissioner working in the same way. What the Victims Commissioner could do is have a seat at tables that we are not at. For example, the Criminal Justice Board. There's no victim organisation represented at the Criminal Justice Board at all. And that's obviously a key forum for making decisions all the way through the system. I don't see that role as taken away from voices in the way that perhaps some others are concerned about. In terms of the money, I think it would be interesting to get. We've always said that we're supportive of a Victims Commissioner's position as long as the finances don't take away from frontline services. I think that's the point that we need clarity on first off, and I haven't heard anything so far about where the budget has been identified for this, and whether it may not be money that's going to be better spent, because it might not be money that would have been coming to victims frontline services anyway, I suppose, is the point I would make to that. But getting clarity on that is absolutely right. But we would continue to champion, but I would see the Victims Commissioner role as complementary, not instead of.
I think for us, in the funding point, I think Kate is right. It's not as straightforward as if you're spending this, it means you're taking away from that. But I do think for us, a big part of it, I suppose noticeable to you all, more ambivalence about this is being informed that the government have no funding for these 28 posts we're going to lose, but they're going to have the funding for the Victims Commissioner. That does make it very difficult for us to support it, I think.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, thank you for that. I'm going to swiftly move on to part two, embedding trauma-informed practice. Some questions from members. Again, if I can ask members just to direct questions to either one or two witnesses at the most. And now I'm going to bring in Russell Finlay.
Thanks very much. Yeah, there's a huge amount of ground to cover, but due to the time limits, I'll just ask one question. I want to ask specifically about floating trial diets for sexual offence cases. Now, Rape Crisis evidence say the bill needs to include a specific commitment to dispense with these in these cases. They cause uncertainty, distress, disruption and trauma. And it's not trauma-informed practice. Victim Support Scotland similarly say they're strongly opposed to these. But in a review of this practice by Lord Bonamy, he recommended that they should not be happening in rape cases. Now, that was 21 years ago, and I find that inexplicable, that why they're still happening 21 years later. So given that this bill is a victim's bill, will that now lead to these ending, do you think? And if not, can the bill be amended to make that happen? And because the question relates to both your organisation's evidence, perhaps it's one for Kate and Sandy.
Yes, I agree. I also find it inexplicable. It was a clear recommendation from Lord Bonamy that particularly for rape cases, given how distressing a prospect it is giving evidence in these cases, that there needs to be certainty. And we are so far away from that now. And I think there is a distinct lack of ambition in the proposal for a specialist court, sexual offences court. It seems to me the absolute basic thing we need to do if we're going to have a trauma-informed specialist court is not to have floating trial diets. They cause so much distress. It's not the way to get best evidence. And I appreciate that the specialist court, which I know the committee will come on to look in, does have a default of giving evidence in advance of the trial. But some people will still want to give evidence at a live trial. And even if they give evidence in advance, they might still want to go and observe the proceedings and see what's happening with their case. I think if we're serious about trauma-informed practice, the most basic thing we should be doing is not having floating trial diets used in rape cases.
It doesn't need to be part of the sexual offences proposals. That can just be done, or should just be done, with an amendment to this bill.
Yeah, and just if I can come in, yeah, we would agree around floating trial diets and their use. So, you know, as you all know, the committee is very well aware about the impact of COVID on delay. Delay was already a big issue pre-COVID. It's now a massive issue, but we've now got, so we're in danger of normalising delay. And that is having an impact on trauma. We're all seeing it. All of the people that we are supporting are feeling it. But what we've also now got is layered on top of that adjournment, deferment at a level that I've never seen before. So the uncertainty, you get cited to go one day, oh no, sent away. You know, and routinely I'm meeting people who that's happened 6 or 7 times, which is leading to witness attrition as well as a kind of overall lack of confidence in the justice system, and it's just really compounding people's trauma. So from our perspective, trauma-informed practice, the provision that's in the bill at the moment is really necessary to have that touchstone there so that there is clarity around prioritisation, because at the moment the priority is going on making sure that we have an efficient use of court space. We don't have, that's the argument for floating trials, is we don't have empty courtrooms, we can't have sheriffs sitting where there's no case coming forward. But there has to be a better scheduling process that makes sure that the cases that may be assigned floating ones do not have vulnerable witnesses in them, for example. And having that touchstone of trauma-informed practice within the bill, I think, is really important for that. It will give us something to use as, no, this is what we should be using as a trauma-informed, and this is not a trauma-informed way of doing things. So, yeah.
Thanks very much. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in John Swinney and then Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. The bill includes provisions that will amend the standards which various organisations have to put in place to ensure that trauma-informed practice is pursued. Now, when I look at the 2014 legislation, the Victims and Witnesses Scotland Act 2014, there's some significant obligations in there that, for example, victims should be treated in a respectful, sensitive, tailored, professional and non-discriminatory manner. Now, as just one of the principles at Section 1A2. And we all can see that that's, well, I shall offer my opinion, that I don't think that's always being applied. So, if that's not always being applied and we're putting trauma-informed practice into the bill, that raises a question with me: is this got sufficient bite about it to make sure that we actually do genuinely embed trauma-informed practice in our legal system? I'm all for it, 100% behind it, but I want to be convinced that the provisions will be effective and emphatic. I'd be interested in your observations on that point that I raise in relation to the obligations that are already on the system in the 2014 Act and whether the provisions in the proposed 2024 Act are going to be sufficiently obligatory. Sandy Brindley, perhaps.
Yes, I think that's one of the most important questions facing the committee when considering this part of the bill, is how do you make this meaningful? Because I share that concern. There are very positive statutory obligations in justice agencies set out in the 2014 Act that are simply not being met. You have seen it. I did a submission to the committee from research that I'm doing as part of a PhD at the law school at Glasgow, interviewing complainers about how much they're able to effectively participate in the justice process, which is also a right set out in the 2014 Act. And the answer is that those rights are pretty meaningless on the ground. And I share the concern about just adding another right to that list of obligations or list of principles in relation to trauma-informed practice without taking action to make sure those rights are actually enforceable. If those rights are not enforceable, they're not meaningful rights. Return to my earlier point, in sexual offence cases, the most effective way I see of doing that is giving sexual offence complainers access to legal representation. Advocacy support is life-changing. That's the feedback we get. It really helps sexual offence complainers navigate the system. But what complainers need in relation to actually accessing the rights that are there on paper is legal advice.
And for me, we do share your concern. We see the Victims Commissioner as having a key role within that. Absolutely. Those rights and the standards of service are only meaningful if they're effectively monitored and if agencies are held accountable to complying with the standards. So we think it's a missing part of the puzzle at the moment, but we do see the Victims Commissioner as having a key role within that too.
Just add really quickly, I agree with everything there, but I think what we said in our response was we all agree we want a system that's trauma-informed, but that it is really essential to understand that the way trauma-informed is rolled out these days is not necessarily domestic abuse competent. We were quite involved in working with Carolyn Bruce and the development of the guidelines and skills framework for trauma-informed practice and justice. And even there, we were quite concerned about the lack of specificity about what are the behaviors that we need to see change. What does good trauma-informed practice look like? So we agree with it, with the intent, but we think it needs to be much more specific. We need to have really explicit commitments to And obviously, the bill's not going to say, well, you know, this is exactly what it looks like for each individual area. But what we do need is a set of standards that are then applicable to holding organizations accountable for identifying the behavior that's not appropriate, and this is implementation science, identifying the preferred behavior and then supporting professionals to move and holding them accountable if they don't. And that's the piece of work that has never happened since 2014.
Okay. Thank you. Just one further question. In the 2014 Act, the obligation to pursue those principles I talked about is applied to the Lord Advocate, the Scottish Ministers, the Chief Constable of Police Scotland, the Scottish Court Service and the Parole Board for Scotland. Does that cover sufficient organisations?
No, I don't think it does. I mean, we've in our submission, housing's a big issue, and often in context of domestic abuse and other types of crime, victims are ending up homeless, for example, or with massive coerced debt. So we think that there are other statutory organisations and other bodies who should be included within the standards of service, because their roles extend across victims, and that trauma-informed decision-making with respect to those victims should be applied.
Okay, thank you, Kevin.
Very much. Before I move on, Anne-Marie, do you want to come in on any of that at all?
Yes, I agree again with Kate that the difference between the 2014 obligations and the proposals now is that we may have a victim and witness commissioner there to make sure that the other organisations are held accountable. I think coming back to the victim's point of view, as a survivor of childhood sex abuse and rape and all sorts of stuff, and also having witnessed my family and my sister go through the murder trial of our son, trauma is trauma. There's no, you know, there's. I don't think there's any various stages of priority in trauma and priority in victims. They should all be treated the same. And I do think that the introduction of the commissioner will ensure that all of their rights are equal, and that they all get their voices heard.
Okay.
Can I just come back on one point? Because I think that the issue of accountability and the role that Anne-Marie Hukosa quite properly sets out for the Victims Commissioner is at the heart of these proposals. But the interaction on the point of accountability that I raised earlier on raises some pretty significant issues about the way in which our system operates. You know, if the Lord Advocate was here, she would say, I am independent. If the Chief Constable of the Police Service of Scotland was here, she would say, I am independent. The Scottish Court Service would say, I'm independent. And what my line of questioning is getting at is how do we fulfil the very legitimate aspirations that Anne-Marie Kokosa has put on the record about making sure these standards are properly applied and that people are properly treated, and that's the big test that I think's relevant to as part of the bill.
Yeah. I think there is something there about how are victims and complainers informed about the standards at the moment. I mean, you need to get out your way to find them, and it's really not that accessible a document. I think we need to be much better at informing victims of what their rights actually are and what they can do if those rights are not being upheld in practice.
And I think, you know, some of the postholders that you've described in terms of their independence, they also have a responsibility to make sure that their organisations are upholding the standards of service. They need to be not tokenistic, I guess, in the way that they are just now. They need, and part of that is being held to account around what they're delivering or not delivering in line with those standards of service. But we, you know, I've been really clear about this. I I think the standards of service themselves need a review. The organisations that they apply to needs to be widened and reflect properly the lives of victims and witnesses. And some of the standards of service, for example, are joint standards. So the rights for victims to get support, but they don't filter down in each organisation individually. So they kind of sit in this kind of vacuum at the top, and no one takes responsibility for then informing, for example, victims about their rights properly. So I think there is a piece of work there, just in answer to your question, really about making that absolutely clear and making it clear with the heads of those organisations about what their roles and responsibilities are in respect of that.
Thank you very much.
If I can just bring in Rona, we really do have to move on. So apologies, Marcia. Rona, and then Fulton.
To follow on, and then I've got a question for Marcia. But just to follow on that line, I think it's hugely positive that this has been written into the bill. But I completely agree with the conversation that we've just had. So should that set of standards be spelled out more in the bill, such as, for instance, court reorganisation, so that victims don't meet perpetrators, communication with victims, conduct of defence, and I take John Swinney's point about independence, but should we be more explicit rather than just saying it should be trauma-informed practice? Would that be the... If it's doable, should we do that?
I'm not sure. I think there's a limit to what you can put in a bill, and I think, while not disagreeing with it, the point that trauma is trauma, a one-size approach does not fit all. Different victims have different needs and will want to give their evidence in different ways. Mm. For example, for me, more important than putting words about trauma in the face of the bill, it's about mechanisms for informing victims of their rights and enabling them to access those rights. To me, that's what we need more of in the bill, is a recognition of those mechanisms of accountability rather than putting more in the bill. I mean, as Mr. Swinney pointed out, there is a lot of the 2014 Act that, if it was happening, victims would be having a much, much better experience. But the difficulty is that gulf between what the legislation says and what's happening in practice, and the challenge is how do we breach that gulf between the two. And I don't know that it is about putting more words in the bill around what we mean by trauma-informed practice. I think it's about those mechanisms.
I kind of disagree, in the sense that I think we should be spelling it out a bit more, but that's a point for conversation. Marcia, Dr. Scott, can I ask you, in your submission, you say that you'd like to see more about the specialised nature of domestic abuse in respect of being trauma-informed in the bill. Could you maybe expand on why you think that's important?
Well, one of the themes that came up when we were reviewing the skills framework with Caroline Bruce for Justice was that when you don't have a gendered and domestic abuse lens and you look at the recommendations for trauma-informed, what you see often is a default position that the experiences of victims is because they're vulnerable rather than because there was a perpetrator involved and the system failed to keep them safe. Mm-hmm. We saw that all the way through, whether there was a failure to recognize that that something like 75% of the victims who have PTSD are women and children because of domestic abuse and sexual assault, and that the responses of our system are gender blind and are assuming that it's because they're women that they're vulnerable or they're children that they're vulnerable, rather than we have a system that privileges the needs and rights of other people. In terms of domestic abuse competent, for instance, you may say that, what we don't see with a trauma-informed approach that's not domestic abuse competent is that they fail to look at the actions of the perpetrator and understand that those provide constraints around the actions of victims, and that unless you can see those constraints and you see the behaviors of the perpetrator, you ascribe all of the problems that this victim has, who's been traumatized, to that vulnerability rather than to the system's failure to hold him accountable. Sure. Can I just say the other thing I would say is I do think we need more specifics, but I don't think it's an either or. I agree with Sandy that there's a whole variety of things that need to happen to make our system trauma-informed. And I'm going to sneak this in because I didn't get it in before, which is data. You know, part of the difficulty that we have with holding people accountable is that the system, so for instance, when I asked the Crown for data about what percentage of the domestic abuse cases that are carried forward for charge and then wind up with a conviction involve families with children, they don't know because they don't collect that data. So I can't tell you how many of them should have a child aggravation. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. So unless we associate those standards that we would like to see implemented with data collection and equalities data, then it's very difficult to hold the Lord Advocate or the Chief Constable or any of those people accountable. Yeah.
So basically you're saying we should work together and be much more transparent about, because we all want the same thing, so much more transparent about information and data, and it should be collected. Yeah. Okay, thank you, Convener.
Thank you. And I'll finally bring in Fulton McGregor, and then we'll move on to part three.
Hey, thanks, Convener. I wanted to ask about it's following on from the conversation that Rona Mackay had with the panel there about how much you think this bill is trying to change more of a cultural shift in the justice agencies, because trauma-informed practice has been around for a long time. I think most folk that are involved in the sector in one form or another are pretty clear on what it is. Your agencies sitting here today have been practising it with victims of crimes for many years to a high standard. But I think that outside your agencies, the rest of the justice sector is predominantly concerned with the accused or ultimately the offender if they're convicted. And I know that from my time as a justice social worker. And trauma-informed practice with offenders is a pretty big thing. It's a pretty important thing, as you can imagine as well. But even within justice social work, there was only limited, minimal scope for work with the victims there. So how much do you think that this bill is really trying to look at agencies across the boards of justice social work, like I mentioned, but also the courts, to take more into account the victims and do that in a trauma-informed manner?
Come in there, yeah. Okay. I mean, I do think the trauma-informed is really important, that it's in the bill for exactly those reasons. I do think it would be helpful to have a bit more detail in there. What we don't want is the whole system going through a half-day trauma-informed training course and then pretending that it's trauma-informed. So, and going back to the point that was made about the 2014 Act, actually, this is more than just about individual behaviours and being polite. It's about processes, systems, policies, training, approaches. It's about embedding a trauma-informed approach across the entire justice system, and this is exactly the right starting point. I think you need it. I think you need it there to help with that. I totally agree. But making it clear that it's about processes, policies, approaches rather than just individual behaviours, I think would really help solidify that message, I guess, around cultural change and the expectations around that, and likewise the standard, including that explicitly within the standards of service for each organisation.
Thanks. Sandra?
Can I say that there's one example that a complainer gave me in the research that I'm doing that I think really sums up what you're saying there about the focus on the accused, where she phoned VIA for information about her case, and you need to give the accused name, and VIA and the Crown Office said to her, "And what are you to him?" And to me, that really distilled just how accused-focused the system is. But also, I think too often when we're organising the justice system and particularly court scheduling, it's system-focused and it's the priorities of the system. And that really is what the floating trial discussion is about. But not just floating trial diets. So another complainer gave the example, I've been called to give her evidence at 3:45 on a Friday, having already been told that if she wasn't taken by 3:00, she wouldn't be taken. And she described feeling so destabilised by that she could barely say her name when she was called to give evidence. And I think anyone could recognise that taking a rape complainer to give evidence at 3:45 on a Friday, when they then wouldn't be able to talk about it all weekend and they need to come back on the Monday to give their full evidence, that is the opposite of trauma-informed. And that's because that is the system's need. The system's need to have courts running till 4 o'clock is more important than thinking about what is the impact on this really vulnerable witness waiting to give evidence. So I think we need a whole-scale shift in this system's focus to make sure we're incorporating within that system's focus the needs of complainers and how do we enable complainers to give their best evidence. And it's not by taking that approach of the system always coming first.
Can I add really quickly that we have been pushing, along with some of our colleagues, trying to push the system to implement virtual trials in domestic abuse cases. We have overwhelming amounts of evidence that this will reduce trauma for victims, probably improve the evidence in the case, and not prejudice the experience of the accused in the eyes of the court. And the virtual trials were opposed by mostly defense solicitors, and this then comes down to how is it that we can get the system to actually respond to the needs of victims, because what has happened is we've had almost no movement in terms of implementing virtual trials. We've had a number of proposals that have been opposed generally by different elements of the legal community, the system, instead of saying, well, we hear your concerns, but there's no evidence underneath them. And yet, you know, this committee was offered, you know, a huge amount of evidence about how much it would reduce trauma to use virtual trials. And yet the system has been very resistant. And I think that's a really good example of the focus on the accused and creating structures that make the system work rather than that actually deliver justice for victims.
Okay, thank you. Very briefly, Anne-Marie.
Just very briefly, I think it's what Kate says, I agree with her, because is very true. It shouldn't become a half-day tick box exercise. You know, it should be embedded in really from police training college, that we attend these, we go up there quite a lot in lecture, and they're not given anything about trauma-informed practices at all. No. And also, we can talk about trauma-informed and that ticks boxes because, as you say, it's been around for a long time. But trauma-informed and trauma-skilled are two different things. We need the support, the people who support our vulnerable, to be trauma-skilled in what they're doing. And I know what you said is helpful, because if it is more detailed, then it gives a better teaching framework for yeah.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. We're going to move on to part three, final part, you'll be glad to hear, focusing on special measures for civil cases, and we'll run up to 11:25. So I wonder if I can maybe open up questions, and I'm going to direct my first question to Marcia, Dr. Marcia Scott. Some organisations have submitted responses, especially those supporting individuals with lived experience of the civil justice system, have suggested that the scope of who is deemed to be vulnerable, in other words, automatically treated as vulnerable, should be broadened. So I wonder if you can maybe just outline your view insofar as does part three sufficiently strengthen the protection available to individuals who are involved in a civil court case. I'll come to you, Marcia.
I think you know from our response that we don't think it does. I find it gobsmacking, frankly, that that a woman can be offered certain protections in a criminal case and then wind up with almost the same set of actors in a civil case and be, you know, confronted by her perpetrator or a whole variety of situations. This is all exacerbated at the moment by the lack of access to solicitors. So we have women dropping out of cases because they can't get a solicitor or having to represent themselves and actually cross-examine their perpetrator. You know, I mean, there are a variety of circumstances that are just ridiculously traumatic. Mm-hmm. And I find it actually quite confusing to understand why courts are so resistant mm-hmm. to what are really a set of very simple special measures. I'd like to see much more significant ones required. So, yes, I mean, to come down to it, we would really like to see the same availability and requirements on courts for special measures. And at the very least, for anybody involved in a domestic abuse case, any victim involved in a domestic abuse case, that access to those special measures should be automatic yeah. and should not rely on the decision of the sheriff.
Okay, thank you for that. Kate Wallace, do you want to come in on that, add anything at all?
We agree.
Okay.
Make thank it you. Easy for you, save your time.
That's the sort of answer we like. Sandy, then.
I think you'll find there's a general consensus here. My reading of the bill as it stands is that for a woman taking a civil damages action for rape would not be automatically covered by the bill, which just seems nonsensical to me. Absolutely, we should be looking at the same approach as in the 2014 Act to deemed vulnerable by the offence.
Thank you for that. I'll open it up to members. Russell Finlay.
Thank you. The written evidence in that respect is overwhelmingly powerful and clear. But I'd like to ask something else in a similar vein. Now, we know that some abusers will weaponise the justice system to continue their abuse. They'll launch costly and often spurious civil proceedings in tandem with criminal cases, costly emotionally and financially. And then they use these parallel processes to sort of seek delays to one and the other, adding to the delays and distress. Now, in the evidence from Rape Crisis say that civil courts should, quote, stop their processes being used as a means of abuse. And there's been some suggestion or discussion around the proposal of a single sheriff dealing with cases where there's civil and criminal cases in tandem. The Cabinet Secretary, when we raised this with her last week, seemed reasonably receptive to the concept. I just wonder if you do agree that with that model that's been said before, but if this bill can be amended to make that happen, and if so, how? And I suppose because Marcia Scott's been most vocal on this, perhaps it's one for you.
Well, as you know, I do. I've been proposing that we find a way to close the gap between criminal and civil cases. Very, very important in domestic abuse, because one of the single biggest reasons that women won't call the police is because they're worried about what's going to happen in a custody and visitation civil matter that might be in front of them down the road. I don't think there's an easy, quick answer to this, but I do think that what we have heard from some judges in the United States is that when they have implemented a single judge or sheriff model, that it has greatly improved information flow from the criminal, because obviously it's the same sheriff. We would really recommend it, and I do think it should. I would love to have it in the bill. I think probably the way it would have to go in is a pilot, because we would need to test it small. But I think that every sheriff that I've spoken to thought it was a good idea about it also. So it might be actually a miracle that we didn't have a lot of opposition on the part of the system, but we might.
I mean, anyone else can come in if they want, but I'm mindful of time.
You can have cases where it's the High Court and the Sheriff Court involved. So, for example, where someone's waiting to give evidence against their ex-partner on a rape case and there's contact proceedings in the Sheriff Court. And I mean, this is an extremely difficult situation for rape complainers, where there's this protection in the criminal case, where they could have a screen, they could have evidence by commission, but they're expected to attend a contact hearing against the man who's been investigated for raping them. I think that's a slightly more complicated situation, because if it's High Court, Sheriff Court, I'm not sure how that would work, but it seems to me completely inappropriate that you could have child contact proceedings in the Sheriff Court at the same time as you've got such a serious criminal proceeding in the High Court, and that may be something the bill could address.
Okay, thank you. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Pauline McNeill, I think you'd like to come in.
Yeah, thanks. Just a pop-up, what's a clarification probably, Sandy. The civil cases that you're referring to, you're talking about where there's been a conviction and... No.
About that, there's been three civil damages cases in relation to rape, but two specifically where there's been a criminal prosecution that's resulted in not proven, where the women have then taken successful civil damages actions. So those are the examples that I think it would absolutely make sense that these anybody taking a civil damages action for rape should automatically be deemed to have the ability to access special measures rather than the uncertainty before they apply. Yeah.
And there are other, trying to sort of work out what are the range of civil proceedings that this might cover. What else? Contact cases?
Contact cases. There's also, I suppose there's...
In the context of domestic abuse, it can be across a whole range of issues around divorce and access to marital assets. We know that 90%+ of the cases of domestic abuse include financial abuse. So Kate was referencing coerced debt is an increasingly problematic issue. So there are lots of proceedings that happen, and Pauline, you know well that I'm not a lawyer, so I can't list the whole everything that happens in civil cases. But an awful lot of it happens with criminal processes.
In those cases, so for divorce, for example, you're talking about changing the procedures for those cases which there has been a conviction and a civil.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the beginning.
Cases where there's been a conviction and there's a civil case. Say, for example, as you said, the divorce case, you're talking about post-conviction.
Yes.
Yeah. And the non-harassment orders, would they be included in that list?
Well, if there's a conviction under a domestic abuse charge, then non-harassment orders are the default position. So there should be a non-harassment order in place. I'm afraid to say, but not surprised to say, that they're not applied as consistently as we would like to see them. And often they don't cover children because what the sheriff involved may say is, well, we have to sort out child contact arrangements, so we're not going to protect this child from a dangerous perpetrator until we do that. So, again, this having a single sheriff would help with that. I don't think it'll fix it, but it would help with that. We had a case just recently where a woman had 29 citations for contempt for not bringing a child to court-ordered visitation while the police were advising her that it was too dangerous because of the information that they had about this perpetrator that was involved in the criminal case. And I think that is the kind of case that that really demonstrates how dangerous it is that we have this gap between criminal and civil.
But it shouldn't be restricted to cases where there's been a conviction, I think, just to answer that.
Why not?
Well, I suppose the example I gave of civil damages cases where we've got not proven verdicts, we know that on a regular basis that guilty men are walking free for rape from our criminal system. So I think if you then make a conviction the basis for access to protection for seeking civil action, that is a significant barrier to justice there.
That point, Sandy, but just see the range of cases that we're talking about. You saying in every case, whether it's divorce proceedings or anything else, you're saying it should be... I was trying to work out, do you apply special measures where the case has not been heard in the criminal courts and there's not been a conviction or not? I'm trying to...
If somebody's seeking a non-harassment order, I think they should have access to special measures.
One of the things from our perspective is that you often have women who are advised in a civil setting not to talk about the domestic abuse that happened in the marriage or in whatever the circumstances are, and then they wind up in a child contact hearing where. They see that actually the perpetrator is going to be offered significant access despite lots of evidence that it's probably not a good idea. And then they bring in the domestic abuse, and at that point they're not believed because it wasn't brought in at the very beginning. And part of the reason why they're going to be reluctant to bring it in at the very beginning is because they don't have if there's been not been a conviction, if there hasn't even been a criminal case, then they're not offered any protection. So what we're saying is when there is any indication that there's domestic abuse, and there is always evidence that there has been domestic abuse if it's been there, then the witnesses should be deemed vulnerable.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if Kate, Anne-Marie, would you like to just the final...
Just very quickly, because when I read this, it's not our area of expertise, we're not involved in it, but I did find it unbelievable to look at the points and see that the women or victims of crime attending a civil court shouldn't get the same protection as they do in a criminal court.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Kate, is there anything you'd like to add before we finish?
Just that I agree. I don't think it should be predicated on whether there's a conviction or not in a criminal case, and that in the same way that we apply special measures to witnesses that are deemed vulnerable in the criminal court prior to proceedings, we should do exactly the same and mirror the same in civil cases for all the reasons that have been mentioned.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much indeed. We're going to have to pull it to a close there. Thank you to everybody on our panel this morning, and we'll just have a very short suspension to let our witnesses leave. Thank you. Okay, thank you very much, members. So we're now going to move on to our second panel for today. We have several organisations representing groups of people who represent victims of crime or people who may be classed as vulnerable witnesses during court proceedings. So I welcome Dr. Louise Hill, Head of Policy, Evidence and Impact with Children First, Bill Scott, Director of Policy with Inclusion Scotland, and Graham O'Neill, Policy Manager with the Scottish Refugee Council. So a warm welcome to you all. So I'm going to look to having around about an hour for this session. Just like the last session, I'll open up with a very general question, and I will put it first to Dr. Hill, and then I'll work across the room. In relation to the proposal around a victims and witnesses commissioner, I'm just interested in your views as to the pros and cons of creating such a post. So, Dr. Hill first.
Thank you. Thank you, Kavina, and thank you, committee, for having us here today. From our perspective, I think we come at it from quite a balanced point of view. We have seen at Children First the value of having a Children Young People's Commissioner in Scotland. So we are strongly in favour. We can see what difference that makes. So we are very positive around the opportunity of that. We see that there is an opportunity with the Victims Commissioner, but I think probably what the committee's already heard this morning is reflections on how that is operationalised and what difference it makes. The big concern that we have, and particularly with the legislation in general, is we feel children are hidden in this legislation. We feel they are silenced and unrepresented so far. So the concern that we would have, and we say that from a point of view, obviously, of having services across Scotland that are supporting huge numbers, sadly, of children that are impacted by the scale of violence and harm that they've experienced. But we recognise, I suppose, with the recorded crimes of sexual offences against children, 37% of recorded sexual crime was against children. And yet, you know, we're in a position of thinking that, you know, there was no mention in policy memorandums, no consideration really of children. And I think that that's quite a big concern for us as a children's charity. So the question that we would have around the role of the commissioner is where would this victims commissioner recognise the scale of harm that children experience and that children themselves in their own right are victims? And there's lots more that we can say in terms of what provisions we think should be required for children through the process. So I think that that's a really challenging position for us. What we would want to say, obviously, is the importance of the relationship with the Children's Commissioner and how the two interact is really key. And then I think we also have other reflections about how this piece of legislation is cognizant to the other pieces of legislation that we currently have in terms of the Children Care and Justice Bill, in terms of UNCRC, Scotland Bill. So I think there's quite a lot for us to take into account. Mm-hmm.
Thanks very much. That's a very helpful opening commentary. I'll now move to Bill. Bill Scott, bring you in.
Just a slight correction. My job title at the moment is Senior Policy Advisor, not Director of Policy. There is a Head of Policy at Inclusion. I don't want to steal their job. Because I'm now semi-retired, that's why I gave up the Director of Policy role. We haven't consulted with our members, unlike the victim support organisations that you heard before. But I think if we did, they'd be generally in support of the creation of a commissioner. And that's because disabled people, particularly disabled women, are likely to be subjected both to domestic violence and sexual abuse, twice as likely as non-disabled women. Disabled people in general, three times as likely to be victims of violent crime than non-disabled people. So they are often the victims of crime, but disabled people experience of the criminal justice system is that it is not, they are not treated seriously as victims, that the hate crimes, disability hate crimes, for example, are very much underreported and underrecorded, and as is sexual abuse. And I do take into account what Women's Aid have said, because, you know, if it is the case, you know, that in terms of sexual abuse and domestic abuse, if there was a barrier created between those organisations and access to government ministers, I think that would not be a step forward. However, with another hat on, I do have experience of chairing a commission, and I hope we've worked in the Poverty and Inequality Commission alongside other poverty and inequality bodies and not acted as a barrier, not acted in such a way. It will be really important to maintain those contacts, I think, with domestic and sexual abuse organisations represent victims, because we need to continue to be informed directly by their experience and not have it filtered through a commission. I think that's their role. They are lobbyists on behalf of those victims, so we shouldn't prevent them from performing that role. But in general, I think a commissioner could act, and that will be the test. If they are effective in holding the criminal justice system from the beat bobby to the court of session judge to account, and I'll come back to this because it was asked earlier about accountability, and all of those organisations rightly stress their independence from the political process because they do not want political interference in their roles. That's right, that's rightful. But they should not think that they are unaccountable to anybody, because at the end of the day they are accountable to the society in which they operate, and if a victims and witnesses commissioner can hold them to account, then by exposing their failures to the public's gaze, then it may help amend future behaviour. So we are generally supportive of the creation of a commissioner.
Okay, thanks very much, Bill. Graham, I'll bring you in.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thank you to the committee for inviting Scottish Refugee Council. I'm Graeme O'Neill, Policy Manager at Scottish Refugee Council, and I suppose the first thing I would start off by saying is that, you know, we work with people who have experienced severe trauma, often to the complex psychological trauma level, so repeated episodes of serious crime, and I suppose by its nature, sadly, that's what refugee experience is, you know, is you're suffering severe crime. And it may, of course, not always be here in Scotland, and hopefully it isn't in Scotland. And I've got a few words to say about that in a second. But we haven't, like Bill said, from Inclusion Scotland consulted their members on the bill. I would suspect that they would be supportive, the organisations would be supportive broadly of the principle of having a commissioner which is there for victims and witnesses of crime. But the but is we didn't submit written evidence to the committee, so, you know, we acknowledge that, we might be able to rectify that. But Scottish Women's Aid's evidence, I think, is worth just kind of mentioning, that we thought it was like a genuine substantive equality analysis dealing with structural issues. And as such, we associate ourselves because, you know, we work with a group that sadly is systemically marginalised and frankly in the most brutal way possible currently by the UK government through its Nationality and Borders Act and Illegal Migration Act systems. There may or may not be time later on for me to expand on that, but put it this way, they're put in the most grim, vulnerable position, refugees, as a result of those two pieces of legislation, to the point of being criminalised and systemically exploited, amongst others, by organised crime groups. Anybody, I think, that doesn't feel that, I think needs to speak to senior officers within the criminal justice system, particularly in Police Scotland and others. So we're supportive in principle. We also associate ourselves with the comments from Louise from Children First, in terms of that we have had a fantastic experience with the Children and Young People Commissioners in Scotland. They have really put their weight as much as they can within their competence, refugee rights issues, such as asylum seeking families getting put into like 37 box rooms in the south side of Glasgow through a so-called mother and baby unit 2 years ago, and the Children's Commissioner listened and worked with those women and those children to get them out of that box room. Those box rooms ran by the Home Office and its asylum accommodation contractor, Mears. And that was an example of a human rights intervention that really kind of stood by the people who may be reserved, but they are not. People aren't reserved or devolved. People are people within a country. So there's a real need, I think, to avoid... Lise put it very well, so I might not put it as well as Lise did, but, you know, there's a real unintended consequence, a risk of in creating too many commissioners and not having clearly defined roles that you could segment the scrutiny landscape. And that would be something you wouldn't want to do if we're wanting to deal with substantive cross social issues, if you like. On refugees, frankly, refugees are a completely hidden group in relation to Scotland, apart from the Children and Young People's Commissioner, a completely hidden group in terms of Scotland's inspectorate regulatory community. It just doesn't happen. We have consistently said to Police Scotland, the Police Inspectorate, and to a lesser extent to the Crown Office Inspectorate, please look at the experience of refugees within the criminal justice system. It hasn't happened within the 22 years of devolution. So there's actually a real hidden world there. So that informs our view and principle. We're supportive of this. Maybe I can talk about a particular illustration later on in the session. Thanks.
Great. Thanks very much. Thanks for that, Graham. You're right, we've got a lot to cover. So I'm just going to open up questions to other members if they'd like to come in. I think Sharon would like to come in, and then I've got Pauline and then Russell. So Sharon.
Thank you. This first question to Dr. Louise Hill. In your submission, you've put Children First support the proposal to establish a victims commissioner. However, the commissioner should not be brought in at considerable expense to act as a substitute for real action in improving experiences of victims and witnesses. Could you tell me more about what action you would like to see happen, and would it require legislation?
Okay. In terms of action of the commissioner, mm-hmm. Right. So thank you for the question. I think that is our reflection in terms of it's got to make a difference, essentially. That's our kind of, you know, top line. We would want a role like this to make a difference for children. So what's, I suppose, essential around that is the level of raising profile, the level of accountability that we've discussed, the level in which they are able to, kind of elevate to an even greater extent the voices of children that are victims. Obviously, that's from our perspective at Children First, but all victims would be relevant. And I think that what we're concerned about, say particularly around legislation, is, and has been demonstrated already, we've had a lot of legislation for victims. We are very concerned at how much legislation that should make a difference to child victims remains unimplemented. So one of the key tasks I would like a commissioner to do would be scrutiny of that legislation, specifically the Children Scotland Act 2020, the Vulnerable Witnesses Recorded Evidence Act 2019, to look at pre-recorded evidence for children, which comes from Lady Dorian's review, evidence and procedure review, you know, was already discussed by Lord Carloway. In our research that we did with the University of Edinburgh in 2023, so this year, we found that we couldn't find evidence of children giving pre-recorded evidence. So even though this was, you know, put in evidence and procedure review in 2015, it is still not acted upon, and in our kind of study that we'd done with North Strathclyde, two police divisions, four local authorities, and across one large sheriffdom, we were not finding evidence of children giving pre-recorded. So the challenge for us is that there's fantastic hope and aspiration in so much legislation that we've passed through the Scottish Parliament, The huge challenge for us is seeing what we'd call the implementation gap. So all good intentions, a huge amount of work done with, rightly so, scrutiny through parliamentary process. But does it make a difference to children and families in our day-to-day work? Well, sadly, our experience of going along to court, supporting children and young people, you know, day in, day out across Scotland, is that we are not seeing the use of pre-recorded evidence. We have huge challenges with special measures actually being implemented, and that's only in criminal court. So, sorry, Convener, to take you round to the what would be one of the key tasks of the Commissioner is we would say scrutiny of current legislation and the lack of implementation of legislation that we've already passed, and holding to account why that is the place, why we continue to have excellent intentions but that do not deliver for children.
So do you think it would take a commissioner to actually do that review, and do you think we should actually continue going with this bill just now, or do you think there should be a halt to go in and look at all the previous legislation that's not been implemented?
I think that's a good question. I don't know if I'm saying with hope and optimism. We currently, I suppose, if it's another way to hold to account and to provide the level of scrutiny that's required on current legislation, then I have hopes that a commissioner could help us with that. So I would say relative, like I know the Cabinet Secretary was very keen to say it was not going to have any impact in terms of frontline services. Like, that's a huge challenge for us, obviously, as a charity in the pressures that we face at the moment delivering for children. But I think if it is one tool, one mechanism which can help us look at why we have so much well-intentioned legislation that has not been implemented, then we're content on balance to say, let's explore this.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'll bring in Pauline McNeill and then Russell Finlay. Pauline.
Thank you very much. So what you're seeing, Dr. Louise Hill, is quite concerning then, that we've been passing legislation in this Parliament that's not been implemented. So my first question is, have you had this discussion with Scottish ministers? Have you raised these concerns with Scottish ministers?
We have.
Mm-hmm. And what response did you get from ministers?
I suppose an equal level of concern that mm-hmm. the good intentions of legislation have not been implemented. We have, obviously, have reflections and our understanding of the impact of the pandemic and what consequences that have had. But, you know, that there is a level of concern that we continue to have this gap of saying the special measures that we've introduced and have been, you know, great in principle. Yeah. This leads us on to part two as well, in terms of what we have in the vulnerable witness legislation, the 2014, which should have been implemented, that we just have a really significant lag in legislation actually being implemented to make a difference for children.
Is it mainly around pre-recorded evidence, or are there other special measures that are not being implemented?
We have lots of examples of other special measures, just in terms of how it works in a practical route, like evidence on commission. We obviously have a huge challenge with, but not a challenge with it happening, not a challenge with us having that in place. But we have lots of practical, like, you know, the other week in Sheriff Court, you know, a young person that's, you know, practical things like the entrance, the separate entrance. Oh, sorry, that it's the wrong time, so we can't unlock the door for you, so you're going to have to walk past the accused. We have children waiting in waiting rooms that have got no access to refreshments, to drinks. They're there off school, so they're there all day, and then told at the end of the day the case isn't going ahead.
I really want to address the question of special measures, because as you see, I thought we had significant reform to that. So that would include screens.
Yeah.
Does that happen, children given evidence behind screens?
Just in the spirit of trying to kind of manage our session, can I maybe ask you to come back in with some questions about special measures just later on, and we'll just focus on Victims Commissioner just now?
Okay. Which is because that was what the evidence that was given. That's fine. I'll wait.
Thank you. okay. Is there anything further? I'll bring you in, obviously, later on, Pauline?
No, no, that's my interest. So
okay,
fine, I'll just
thank
wait.
You. Russell Finlay, I'll bring you in now.
This is quite a general question. In the evidence from Children's First, they state that they're extremely concerned that large amounts of important legislation and policies are being introduced without any clear mechanisms, intentions or resources to implement in full. And you go on to quote, attention and energy needs to be directed towards getting legislation that has already been passed implemented to make the intended difference. I know you've touched on this already, but you cite two specific acts, one being the Children's Scotland Act 2020, large parts of which are still not in force, and the Vulnerable Witnesses Criminal Evidence Scotland Act 2019, which would allow all children to give pre-recorded evidence. This is still only at the early stages of being phased in. So the question is, do you have confidence that this bill, if passed, will be implemented in a timely manner, or is there a risk that it will join the others in this sort of legislation limbo? And perhaps what can we do about that? Are there amendments we can do that will make a practical difference? Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Finlay. I think the honest reflection is it's a concern, because what we're doing with this piece of legislation is we're extending parts of legislation, the Children Scotland Act 2020, that have not yet been implemented. So, you know, that what we've got in place that should be for criminal courts, we'd extend for civil, and yet we don't yet see that in criminal. So in terms of, like, I suppose probably share some views with Dr. Marcia Scott, and try not to do the academic take here, but, you know, on what the data tells us, what the evidence tells us, and what we know around implementation. And sadly, we know that legislation is only one tool for culture change happening, and it can be quite a blunt instrument at times for that change. So one of the challenges I think we have is that we have a huge amount of energy that goes into the legislative process, and I would say less resource and energy then into implementation. And I think probably my panel might agree that the raft of legislation that we have to attend to often means that we're forced to move on to the next piece of legislation, rather than being part, I suppose, constructively of looking, what are the key drivers, what's needed for culture change within the justice system to ensure we make the difference that we want to, which is intended, which is the ethos that sits behind the legislation. And I think we need to do a better job on that.
If I may, pull our questions back to Victims Commissioner. I'm really quite keen that everybody has the opportunity to contribute on that specific issue.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you. Yep.
Okay.
Oh, yes, that's me.
You finished?
Oh, yeah, yep.
Okay, that's fine. In that case, then, I'll bring in Rona Mackay and then John Swinney.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, my questions are solely about the Victims Commissioner. I'll just ask sort of three brief questions to each of you, if that's okay. Dr. Hill, you talked about your good relationship with the Children's Commissioner and how you work well with that. And then you spoke about, problems within existing legislation, etc. How do you see that role? I mean, the Children's Commissioner, should she not be taking that on, or should that be the Victims Commissioner? Do you see a clash there?
Yeah, thank you. It's not that we see a clash. What we see is that clear roles and responsibilities, and a recognition that what we wouldn't want is to child victims to almost fall between two stools, because that sometimes can happen with if you have different roles of, you know, they're children and they're also victims. Mm-hmm. So I think there would just need to be real clarity of what the Victims Commissioner would cover. Mm-hmm. I think, as I said in my kind of opening address, that the concern just is that children need to be recognised, that some children, you know, we have huge numbers mm-hmm. of children that are victims. Mm-hmm. So we wouldn't want the Victims Commissioner to say, well, children aren't my part of the house, that can be dealt with mm-hmm. the Children's Commissioner. Mm-hmm. So I think there'd have to be collaboration.
So you're looking for more clarity on that. That's fine. And I know you'll probably mention this later on, but I just want to see the Bairnshus, and, you know, going back to what you were saying earlier about nothing being done for children, I think that's fairly significant. And I know you will probably mention that later. Bill Scott, can I ask you, do you think there's enough in the bill about disability and inclusion, and do you think that's addressed enough in terms of the Victims Commissioner and his role in that respect?
No, I don't think there's enough in the bill. I'd have to give credit to a sister organisation, People for Scotland. They've done a lot of work in the criminal justice space to identify the needs of disabled people, particularly learning disabled people, but it also affects others. To go back to vulnerable witnesses, learning disabled people, people with mental health issues can be deemed vulnerable witnesses, but it needs someone in the system to identify them as such before an application can be made for them to be so deemed. And the problem is that when people first undertook research with learning disabled people, they found that there's no system used by the police or Procurator Fiscal's office, etc., to identify whether someone, in fact, has learning difficulties. So if the system can't identify that the person has learning difficulties, then they're not likely to apply for your vulnerable witness status. And that means that people who are vulnerable are being exposed to your quite traumatic situations where they've been victims of crimes or witnesses to crime, and yet they're not being afforded the protection that they should be. So more needs to be done in that space. And the Equality and Human Rights Commission did research in 2017, and they found that in the majority of cases where learning disabled people were being interviewed under caution, they were not afforded appropriate adult presence. So if that's what's happening to accused, what is happening to witnesses and victims?
Sorry to interrupt. Is that, in your opinion, is that responsibility of their legal representation to make it clear that they need special measures and they are vulnerable?
Yes, but we go back to how do they identify it? What procedures are in place? What systems are in place? And that's where a victims and witnesses commissioner could make a difference by beginning to say to the police, to Procurator Fiscal's office, etc., what are you doing to identify whether a witness or victim is a vulnerable person? And, you know, in general, issuing reports saying it cannot be correct that your appropriate adults aren't in place when interviews are being conducted. So, you know, they can begin to address some of these problems. But at the end of the day, it comes down to, will they make a difference? Will they take up those cudgels on behalf of victims and witnesses? If they do, then they could make a difference over time.
And actually, how much clout do they have as well?
Exactly.
Thank you. Graham O'Neill, the same sort of question to you. Do you think there's enough refugee recognition?
No, I don't think so. No. I mean, it's a difficult one when how you want to treat refugee within legislation. When you speak to people with refugees, and there's also quite strong reasons, you don't always want to put refugee within primary legislation, obviously with the exception of world-leading, life-saving international instruments like the Refugee Convention, which this current UK government are saving in the UK from. But that putting that to one side, I mean, Bill talked about if the Victim and Witness Commissioner took up the cudgels of exercising scrutiny, that then it had some enforcement teeth or it had some kind of mechanism to ensure compliance by the responsible criminal justice bodies, then we are very supportive. In my open remarks, I talked about the kind of regulatory gap there is in practice among our regulators and the inspectorates in Scotland around refugee experience, including within the criminal justice system. And the more people get punted by the UK government, as they are in its criminalisation agenda, by the UK government, then numbers of people subject to, you know, Police Scotland and the Crown Office won't want this, and we're with them in that, but they are going to have more people who are in liable to the criminal offence of irregular arrival, for example, in the UK, so including in Scotland. More people in police cells. There's been about 4,000 in the last 7 years in Scotland cells. Irregular arrivals, about 66%, we estimate, are from trafficking survivor countries, about over 70% from refugee-producing countries like Afghanistan, Eritrea, etc. So If it can take up the cudgels and exercise some genuine, meaningful scrutiny that affects change, then of course we'll be for that. I mean, there's a couple of really clear areas we would want to see a victims and witnesses commissioner, you know, be pushing and exercising that scrutiny. So one's about the under-reporting and under-recording of hate crimes suffered by refugees, because it's there. We get it a lot in our services work, and we have done for decades. So we've said to the Crown Office in the past, we'd really like you to do some serious research into that, and we really hope they do, and the committee may consider a recommendation to that effect. If it's okay, can we add just one other example to give? A cornerstone of international anti-trafficking law is the non-punishment principle. That's an acutely vulnerable group of people. That is people that have been trafficked into forced criminality, forced criminal acts. So maybe it's like an adult or a young person or a child sometimes been forced into cannabis cultivation. Organised crime always behind that. The current Lord Advocate's instructions, which we support as a prevention mechanism within the 2015 trafficking exploitation legislation, at the moment are not an effective safeguard against the injustice of such individuals being subject to criminal justice processes. There's a complete reliance at the moment on the delayed and Home Office national referral mechanism by the Lord Advocate and the Solicitor General to wait for the Home Office. In an average, you take 450 to 550 days to issue what in the jargon is called a conclusive grounds decision, whether somebody's recognised by the UK state through its Home Office as a trafficking survivor, including these individuals with forced criminality. The Lord Advocate is putting in a completely invidious position by the delayed in Home Office national referral mechanism. But what's happening is, in practice, hundreds of people over the last 6 or 7 years have been left in criminal justice limbo who are actually survivors of forced, trafficked exploitation, forced criminal acts, which is unacceptable from our view from a human rights perspective. These figures are really worrying.
I wonder if I can maybe just come in there.
Yeah.
There is extensive... is there an extensive contribution that you want to make? I'm just thinking about timing. Sure. So if we've got time, we'll come back to some of that.
I mean, that's absolutely fine, of course, convener. It was just to conclude to say that, 384 people over the last 7 years have been through the Lord Advocate's instructions against about whether they were trafficking survivors or not. Only 10%, that is 40 of those 384, have actually had their cases stopped by the National Lead Prosecutor at that point. And the result of those that haven't had those cases stopped is most likely they're left in criminal justice processes. We hope and expect they've not actually been convicted of offences. The reason I raise it is that's precisely the type of issue that if the Victim and Witness Commissioner was able to take up the cudgels, that's the kind of issue that would make a really profound difference. We know and respect the independence of the Lord Advocate. We respect their dedication to this work, and we've met the Solicitor General to that effect. The reason I'm raising it here is that at the moment, we have no way, as a national refugee rights and the anti-trafficking sector, I'm sure would concur with this, to actually, in Scotland, get a grip on the issue. Yeah. There's a regulatory gap in practice, is what I'm saying. Yeah. Okay. So we need to try and address it, and that's why we think it's relevant. So thank you for your patience.
Thank you. Okay, thanks very much. Thank you for your forbearance. I know that you're very passionate about that. We're going to bring in John Swinney, and then I'll bring Katie Clark, who's online.
Thank you, Convener. I'm interested, Dr Hill, in the opening part of your written statement, which Sharon Dowie referred to earlier on, where you said that a commissioner should not be brought in at considerable expense to act as a substitute for real action in improving the experiences of victims and witnesses, such as consistently scaling up the Bairnshuis model following the recent very welcome developments that were the subject of my colleague Rona Mackay's debates in Parliament. We all know that money's tight, so what's the priority?
Okay. So, thank you for the recognition. And obviously, we are delighted to have opened Scotland's first Bairnshuis. It's a phenomenal kind of time for us. I suppose there is a recognition, though, that funding did not come through the Scottish Government. Mm-hmm. So we went through other sources, because we've always said that we not only want to describe the problem for child victims, but we think we have a solution, and the Bairnshuis is for us a solution. But we really recognise and are thankful for the political support that we've got, and we hope for the extended rollout. I suppose what we always loop back round to is, will this make a difference for children? And fundamentally for us, the provision of the Barnet House model will make a huge difference to children and their families. So I don't know if it's a difficult position to say an either or. In some ways, obviously, the commissioner role is the, you know, a collective advocacy point of view. We would want them to be a huge champion for the Barnet House. In terms of the costings and money being tight, the purpose of Barnet House is it's one child-friendly, you know, space house that means that children do not have to go to multiple different settings, and that their evidence is taken at the soonest opportunity, which would have quite considerable implications for not going through lengthy, drawn-out court processes, which have, you know, considerable costs associated to them. But, you know, we want Barnet House because it's the right thing to do for children. So we're not saying it in terms of from a cost perspective. But it's a kind of critical area, I think, for us that we want to make a difference on the ground.
OK, thank you. So would it be fair to conclude from that if you had a choice over the same pot of money, would you put it into a Barnet House rather than a Victims Commissioner?
Thank you, Mr. Swinney. So I think fairly from the position that we have at Children First and from listening to children, our decision would be that we would put that money into a Barnet House.
Okay, thank you for that. One other issue for me, I hear what you're saying about the absence of, for the lack of references in the policy memorandum and documentation to the perspective of children. What is it about the Victims Commissioner that you think can, what do you think the Victims Commissioner could do that the Children's Commissioner currently cannot do in asserting the interests and protecting the rights of children?
Yeah. So there's a key kind of critical role that the Victims Commissioner could do, which is in response to the scale of criminal justice reform that we have. And we think that the Victims Commissioner could have an important, loud voice in that process, of which we have various pieces, obviously, of legislation. And they could apply the pressure, the scrutiny, the accountability that's required from a victim's perspective, ideally for us, in collaboration or in tandem with this being raised from the Children's Commissioner perspective. Child Victims has not to do any disrespect to an excellent Children's Commissioner's office, but Child Victims has not been one of their areas of particular, you know, scrutiny or concern. It's not been an area where they've looked at strategic litigation around child victims. They've not had a particular kind of strategic focus on this group, partly because their remit for all children, over 1 million in Scotland, is quite big. So we understand that. So I think that it is recognising that the victims, what our experience has been at Children First, is that we're often invited to meetings where we are the voice of raising the issues for children, and we're often the only person at the meeting, and there's many, many that are advocating for adult victims. So we would really want the Victims Commissioner to recognise the scale of harm and victimisation that we have of children in Scotland, and how their role can hold up some scrutiny and accountability on that matter.
Okay. Thank you, Camille.
Thank you. And I'll bring in Katie Clark online. Katie. Katie, do you want to come in? Your microphone seems to be showing us on. Can you hear us?
I can now. Sorry, it said that the host wasn't allowing me to unmute myself, so apologies for that. I think Graham has spoken quite powerfully of the need to strengthen the powers of the Commissioner, and Louise about the implementation gap. which is a powerful criticism, not just of the Scottish Government and the justice system, but indeed the Parliament itself and its scrutiny role. So I suppose what I'm interested in is why we would believe that another voice of criticism and perhaps focusing on some of the failures of the system is likely to be effective unless it has the power to intervene in cases. And it may be that the panel all have a view on that. I think Graham perhaps has already said that that power should be there. Is that the view of all of the panel?
Dr. Hill, do you want to start off and then we'll bring in Bill?
Yeah, so thank you for the question. Like, I'm not a legal expert, so I'm just aware of trying to make sense of the range of evidence that's already been provided to the committee of potential complications of the individual investigative powers that could come in place. So I would say only from a very kind of basic perspective that it seems that there is strength amongst panels that have provided evidence so far that they think that it would have a role. I think it would need to be thought through very carefully. But we think if that would make a difference, then, you know, we would be supportive of that.
I think we would be as well, in exceptional cases, to have that investigative power. Yeah. Yeah.
OK, Katie?
No, I think that's helpful. So are all the panel agreed that both investigatory ability but also the ability to directly intervene in cases is necessary for the commissioner to be effective? Is that a fair reflection on what you're saying?
Okay. Graham, do you want to come back in?
Yeah, I think it would need to be handled really carefully, given a ton about criminal matters. So it's just to kind of say that, you know, that, you know, people's liberties at stake, you know, the independence of the Lord Advocates, you know, something that we have in Scotland, which is, you know, it's, I suppose it's a, for us, it's a bigger deal here that needs to be worked through quite carefully if we're going to do that. Now, I raised the example I did with the Chair's forbearance to basically make the point that we do think there's a big problem there, and we've employed in the jargon a lot of inside track work. We're not just saying this today, we've done this 3 years, we've spoke with the Crown Office and Police Scotland about this. And it tells us that there's a regulatory gap, and the Victim and Witness Commissioner could fill that gap. In order to fill that gap, I suppose, to answer part of your question, Katie, is that it would actually need to have teeth, and it would have to a way to enforce things to happen. At the moment, I don't see that adequately within the legislation. That's a part of that teeth making things happen may or may not be being able to intervene in individual cases. But I think there's wider things that should be, I would hope, in the gift of the Parliament and the Scottish Government to do around strengthening the investigative powers in relation to the criminal justice sector in terms of how it treats victims and witnesses. Yeah.
So, one of the examples that was used by Louise was the fact that the children aren't being allowed to give evidence remotely, virtually. Is that something that there should be a legal mechanism, if you like, that the commissioner would be involved in so that there could be intervention? Is that the kind of area that you think would need to be explored to make this effective?
Louise Hill, do you want to come in?
Thank you, Katie. I suppose my... potentially, sorry, my head's going, how would that work? And I suppose it's just thinking that how complicated some of our work is when it's live criminal proceedings that we're supporting children already. And I think for us, could I just say that the ethos that is underpins our whole approach to supporting children through the justice system is not having to retell their story and involve lots of different professionals in their life unnecessarily. Like, that is a key principle. So I suppose I'm thinking about it in various ways of, you know, unintended consequences of potentially bringing another body and another person in when we have live cases, that we would be incredibly careful around that as a process. So, yeah, there's an element of me that I'm like, gosh, it's complicated enough, Katie, if I'm honest, of working it through.
Mm-hmm. I'm grateful for those answers.
That's okay.
Okay, thanks very much. Okay, I'm just watching the time and I am going to have to move us on to looking at parts two and three. So if we can, I'll open it up to members to ask questions on part two, which is embedding trauma-informed practice. So if any members particularly would like to come in, Fulton McGregor.
Thanks, Convener, and good afternoon now to the panel. I want to ask about the trauma-informed practice, and for those of you, I think it was all of you actually were in for the last session, you've heard the discussions that we had with the previous panel. So I'm wanting, I suppose, firstly, a general response to what you think, what difference you expect or hope that the provisions will make in practice. And I also want to ask you about the question that I asked the previous panel as well, is if you think that partly the intention of the bill is to create that cultural shift, because again, like the previous panel, all of yourselves and your organisations already use trauma-informed practice with victims and people that you work with. But how do you think that that can be increased across the whole justice system? And what role can this bill have in delivering that? Happy to start with yourself first, Dr. Hill, and then
yeah. Okay. Thanks, Mr. McGregor. So I suppose a kind of opening statement is that our whole system is not trauma-informed and does not work for children. So the perspective that we would have is that our current system for children is highly traumatising. And we know that through, you know, years of experience of working alongside children directly on trauma. It should be deeply worrying, and I know it is to the committee, that the experience of court itself is more traumatic for children, some have said, than the actual experience of abuse and harm. So that's just worrying to put out in itself. I suppose our reflections on it is there is a solution to this, and the solution would clearly be for us that we do not want any child in Scotland as a child victim or witness to go to court. We think that we have a pathway for this from the words of Lord Carloway, from the work of Lady Dorian on the evidence and procedure review. We feel we have a route now. We've also had legal opinion kind of from eminent QC on the possibility of the Barnahus House. But we feel that there's in some ways a very simple way of taking the experience of trauma in our justice system out for child victims and witnesses. And our suggestion is that we stop making children go to court. So that's a kind of basic for us. So in some ways I could say, what might it mean for us to do, you know, trauma-informed training for judges and for sheriffs? And yes, fully, you know what I mean, kind of supportive of that. But my very strong preference and the preference from, you know, my colleagues across Children First is there's a much easier route to this, that we stop making children have to go to court. And the deep worry, I suppose, that we have is that although there has been, you know, since 2013, statements to say and cross-political kind of support to say that we shouldn't be doing this, and that we know, certainly as a research perspective, how re-traumatising the experience of going to court is for children, that, you know, we continue to be in a position where it happens, and it happens daily for the children. So
where do you think the stumbling block in the system is? Because you're absolutely right. There's complete cross-party support for children not being in court as an ordinary occurrence. I sat in the Justice Committee in the previous session, the Vulnerable Witnesses Bill that you mentioned, there was other previous bills as well, as did Rona Mackay. So where is the stumbling block in the justice system that kids are still contained to court? That, you know, where is it, and how can this bill help to address that?
So I think you talked, Mr. McGregor, about culture change, and we face, I suppose, just huge resistance to change of a very traditional adversarial system. So despite what the research evidence tells us, despite the international learning that we have, but we continue, I suppose, to have the on-the-ground challenge of almost a wish to see children in court. We have lots of examples still of children being cross-examined in a court setting, even though we said that that wouldn't happen anymore. You know, we have some awful examples of that regularly. We have examples of children not going to court, going to a vulnerable witness suite, but the experience of that still being very traumatic for them. So, for example, one of the girls that's been involved in our change makers and our sharing stories for change work, you know, said that, you know, her mum had to go and give evidence on the same day. So her mum, who's her comfort blanket, you know, who's that rock throughout all what's happened to her, she has to go. So, we're supporting her at Children First, but we're going along to a vulnerable witness suite. And she, you know, she talks about what that experience is like. And it's better perhaps than the going to court, but it's still not in any way a trauma-informed response to children. So, you know, what can this bill do? I suppose, possibly as currently framed in part two, it's still tinkering around the edges for us. It's still kind of saying, let's make sure we have trauma-informed. Like, we obviously are huge advocates for that and support for it, but what we don't want to do is just make people a little nicer and understand a bit about child development in the traditional court system, and we still put children and families through that when we know that that is a source of trauma in itself.
I read through some of the written evidence that was sent to the committee, and faculty advocate says the faculty remains of the view that legal professionals within the justice system already possess the necessary skills and experience required to recognise and adapt practices for the benefit of persons who may have experienced trauma. Beg to differ. Professor Sharon Cowan carried out research on behalf of the HRC in 2020 that looked at the use of Section 275 applications in cases of rape, and what her findings were based on, because she says there's very little data available. The last data available was produced by the Justice Secretary back in 2016, which showed that 90% of Section 275 applications went through unopposed by the Crown. And that was almost exactly the same statistic as in 2003, when those statistics were last revealed to the public before 2016. They are not routinely collected, so we do not know what the current situation is. That is where a victims commissioner could step in, and again, to come back to it, why this is particular importance to disabled women, twice as likely to be subjected to sexual abuse and rape. And the victims are not being protected by the system. Prosecutors do not routinely object to the defence exposing the sexual history of women in court, even although the law says that that should be the exception rather than the rule. It's the rule. 90% go through unopposed. So we need somebody to stand there and say to the faculty advocates, look into this mirror and tell us what you see, because you need this training. You need to adopt trauma-informed practice, because you are not doing it at the moment. You are subjecting the victims of crime to additional trauma, putting them on trial when in fact they are the victims.
It sounds like you're saying in your bill that we need part one, the introduction of victims commissioner, to almost enforce part two.
And that's where the company regulated functions and things like that. We would like to see the victims commissioner with teeth.
I'm conscious of time. Can I just, Dr. Hill, I know you want back in, but I'll leave that to the convener, or not to make that judgment. I just want to ask if Graeme O'Neill can come in from a refugee perspective on the question I've asked, and then that's me finished.
Thank you, Hilton. And we concur particularly with what Lise and particularly what Bill was saying. I mean, if people look in the mirror, I think what the faculty of advocates and others will see, you'll see people like me, white, middle class lifestyle, and actually, quite small C conservative, that has been trained and schooled, which isn't it's understandable, that kind of like quite conventional legal procedure and ways of doing things, and it's in a setting, an inherently adversarial setting, court. So I suppose, the fact that if one's trying to the second part of your question, filtering around, if one's trying to make cultural change within the criminal justice system, then it needs to be a structural change. So in a structural change, I don't see it yet within this legislation. So it needs to be about, you know, serious investment that supports everybody, both victims, witnesses and the staff who are working in that system too, to be dealing with the trauma that they're experiencing and hearing also. That's I suppose, just to that kind of lack of holistic investment seems to be there. Refugees, you know, as I said in my opening remarks, highly traumatised population, significant additional vulnerabilities around, in our context, language support needs. You know, putting people in that into an adversarial situation is inherently traumatising. It will be bamboozling for people as well. And we would imagine there's quite significant access to justice issues that are experienced. Some of the examples we've had over the years with some of our services, we're not confident that criminal defence lawyers in Scotland actually do adequate representation work for people of refugee background in relation to their rights in criminal justice settings.
Okay, thank you. I've got John Swinney and Rona Mackay both want to come in with some follow-up questions, if you can be fairly succinct. So I'll let John Swinney first and then
sure.
Rona.
And mine likewise, Convener. I just want to follow up the exchange between Mr Scott and Fulton MacGregor a second ago there, where Mr Scott was making the point that there is a need for there to be, well, I think was making the point, there's a need for a wider scope around those who should carry the obligation to be trauma-informed, which, so I'd like to put to Mr Scott the point I put to the previous panel as to whether the list of persons to which these obligations should apply, which, again, for the record, are in the 2014 legislation, the Lord Advocate, the Scottish Ministers, the Chief Constable, the Scottish Court Service and the Parole Board, needs to be expanded beyond that level. And does he have anyone in mind?
Well, you know, some of the other agencies that were mentioned earlier, social work and housing, very definitely need to be trauma-informed because, you know, as I say, there is actually sometimes quite a lot of support there for accused people within the system, but for victims and witnesses, you know, there isn't as much. And certainly social work support. I'm thinking of vulnerable witnesses again in terms of learning disabled people. Many of them are known to local authorities, but they're not automatically deemed as vulnerable within the court setting. They still have to have the application. And yet, if they're known to local authorities, why aren't they automatically deemed as vulnerable? So in other words, you know, I'm saying when you're looking at the civil cases as well, because I know we're not going to get on to it, I think there are grounds there for treating some witnesses as automatically vulnerable who are not currently treated as such.
And what about the legal profession?
I think the legal profession should be able to account, very definitely. As I say, there's a difference between independence and accountability, and the legal profession should recognise that.
Thank you, Kavir.
Rona Mackay.
Yeah, just very briefly for Graham, and I'm asking you a question I should probably know the answer to, just for clarity. Do refugees currently have the right to language support and interpreters when they go to court?
Yeah, they do in terms of criminal justice settings, yes. But it's not. But the deeper in the issue to emphasise here is there's a lack of interpreters. And also there's, and I suppose one of the things that we think is definitely the Scottish Minister's gift is to introduce some regulations to ensure standards across the board for interpreters, both in terms of the training of them, the regulation of them, and then, of course, through those two things, the capacity, the amount of interpreters, there's a huge interpreter gap.
And in the civil side, I'll
confess for the record, I'm not sure. Okay. Certain that, but I can certainly get that to you after.
Thank you. Thanks.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm going to move on, just the back of 12:30, so I'm just going to move on to part three, if I may, which covers special measures in civil cases. So I interrupted Pauline McNeill in her questioning earlier on. So I don't know if you would like to come back in at all, Pauline.
Thanks, Convener. I suppose it was just generally trying to understand, since Dr. Louise Hill had said that of all the legislation that we had passed here, a lot of it's not been implemented, and I was just trying to establish so what measures are being used in court currently.
So I suppose I don't want to say the kind of postcode lottery, but we just find a real mix for even on the day of what children experience in terms of which special measures might be in place. So that might be about whether or not they are a vulnerable witness, whether or not they go into a vulnerable witness suite. It might be whether or not they are going to court and screens are being used. Separate entrances might be being used or might not. There might be consideration of a safe space for the child and family. The challenge that we often have is that it's really difficult for children, you know, every like in taking them to courts and vulnerable witness suite spaces.
Does someone not have to apply for special measures for a child?
Yeah.
So is that not being done?
It is done, but often the decision
then.
Yeah, so it's the decision isn't being made or isn't being communicated in time, or it is being done, they're supposed to happen, and then often what happens for us is you turn up on the day and, you know, there's no screen that's been put in place. You know, it's funny that something that just is so fundamental, often in our experience, and I'm not saying all the time, like we have some good examples as well, but, you know, in many circumstances, we're still having it's only by having our own project workers that are alongside that family that's saying, this needs to be in place, and we have to be very...
Just to be clear, you've got cases where special measures have been applied for but not implemented by the court.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Just if anybody else want to come in on special measures? I wonder if I may just finally open up the question generally and maybe also get Graham and Bill's views on the provisions. So, I mean, in your view, do you feel that Part 3... of the bill sufficiently strengthens the protections that are available to witnesses, vulnerable witnesses, in the civil court space, if you like? So it's quite an open question, but I'll maybe bring Graham and then Bill, and if Dr. Hill wants to add anything in. So Graham, first of all.
Yeah. I'm just going to be very honest and straightforward with the committee. We'll write to you with our more considered views on it. Yeah.
Thank you.
I'd echo some of the concerns that victim support and rape crisis have already raised, which is I don't think there should need to be a conviction in place for special measures to be adopted, if it can be adopted in court before anybody's been convicted, in the criminal court before anybody's been convicted. I don't see the need for there to be a conviction in place in the civil court. And as I was arguing earlier, I think there are other vulnerable witnesses. In other words, we wouldn't dispute the right to women who've been either suffered domestic or sexual abuse or rape for them to be afforded automatic protection and treated as vulnerable witnesses. But I think there are other people in the system, including children and other vulnerable adults, who should probably also get that protection within the civil court system.
Yeah. OK, thank you for that. Dr. Hill, do you want to add anything further?
I suppose just a final thought. I agree with the previous kind of panel in terms of what their concerns were and about the idea of the bar being far too high for access. What I'd say in terms of what it's like for children in their justice journey is there's not such a separation between what's criminal and what's civil. And, you know, it's about having how their whole journey is then experienced. So it's very, very confusing for children and families to go to different spaces, different buildings that, you know, some have things in place for them, some are last minute on the day, or some don't have anything at all, you know. So it's hard for us to, you know, we obviously support those families and are alongside them, but, you know, just putting yourself in the shoes of those children means it's incredibly difficult for them. So the idea of not having special measures in civil cases, when there's huge safety concerns that we often have, you know what I mean, it's just highly questionable for us.
Thank you for that. And I think Russell Finlay, you just want to come in with the final
very quickly on the trauma informed issue. The evidence from Children First talks about limited agencies having to have regard of trauma informed practice. Those that don't in the bill are the judiciary and the children's hearing system, which is going to be expanded. So not only do you want to see this expanded to them, you also want to change the wording of have regard to sort of tighten that up or strengthen it in some way. Is that an easy fix for the legislation?
Due regard?
would be our preference, to make it more powerful.
And encompass those yes, and two definitely, others that you've identified.
Yeah, and I think that that's the kind of original point of just how we have different pieces of moving legislation, and we've got to be cognizant of the involvement of different parts of the system, which children, you know, will come up against, which is particularly the children's hearing system, which is fundamental.
You'd have thought so, yeah. Thank you.
No problem.
Okay, thanks very much. Okay, I'm going to just bring this session to a close. Thank you very much to our panel for your contributions this morning. That completes our agenda in public, and we'll have a short suspension. No, it's not. I beg your pardon. This completes this agenda item, I should say, and then I'll suspend the meeting very briefly to allow our witnesses to leave. Thank you. Thank you very much. So our next agenda item is consideration of two negative instruments. They are the Police Pensions Remedial Service Scotland Regulations of 2023, which is SSI 239 of 2023, and the Firefighters Pensions Remediable Service Scotland Regulations of 2023, SSI number 242 of 2023. And I refer members to paper 4 under section 28.2 of the Interpretation and Legislative Reform Scotland Act of 2010. Instruments subject to the negative procedure must be laid at least 28 days before they come into force. These instruments breach this requirement, as they were laid on the 30th of August and came into force on the 1st of October 2023. The Scottish Public Pensions Agency has explained the reasons for the breach in a letter to the presiding officer, which is in our papers. And these explanations do seem reasonable to me. So can I ask members if you have any further questions on these instruments, or are we content with both? We content? Okay, thank you very much. Okay, thank you very much. That does conclude our agenda in public today. Our next meeting is on the 25th of October, and we'll continue with evidence taking on the Victims Bill. We'll hear from organisations representing the legal profession and a former Victims Commissioner for England and Wales. And this session will again focus on parts 1 to 3. And we'll come back to the views of the legal profession and others on parts four to six later in the year. So thank you, members, and we now move into private session. Thank you.